Are you contented with what you have? Good morning, everyone. This is our reflection question for today. Two old friends met each other on the street one day. One looked sad and almost on the verge of tears. His friend asked, "What has happened to you, my old friend?" The sad fellow said, "Let me tell you. 3 weeks ago, my uncle died and left me $40,000. "That's a lot of money," said his friend. "But you see," the sad man continued, "2 weeks ago, a cousin I never knew died and left me $85,000, free and clear." The friend replied, "That sounds like you have been very blessed." "You don't understand," the sad fellow interrupted. "Last week, my great aunt passed away. I inherited almost $250,000 from her." The friend was really confused and said, "Then why are you so sad?" "This week, I didn't get anything." Let us reflect on a verse from today's reading, specifically verses 7 to 9. "I ask you, God, to let me have two things before I die. Keep me from lying, and let me be neither rich nor poor. So give me only as much food as I need. If I have more, I might say that I do not need you. But if I am poor, I might steal and bring disgrace on my God. I remember when I was still single many years ago and dreaming of having my own family. I had many material aspirations in life, determined to leave the seemingly deplorable life I grew up in as our family business floundered. Being a voracious reader, the stories of broken homes among rich families whose children fought over wealth and inheritance also filled my young mind. The faith instilled by my religious mother in me led me to an unusual prayer, that God won't grant me riches, but just enough. And I also asked God to, if possible, let me and my wife have a simple life so that our children may experience living in an apartment and going through some character-building experiences that would help them fortify their faith. Indeed, happiness is not measured by the amount of money in one's deposit account or one's material success. It is a spirit of contentment, relying on God's providence and feeling secure in what we have. Contentment does not mean that one must give everything away to the poor and be poor, nor does it mean to be bothered by the thought that you are blessed with material wealth. It does not mean that one can just splurge and lead an ostentatious life either, nor does it mean taking a superior posture, comparing one's better fortune than somebody else's, for arrogance may result that may draw us away from God. Contentment means stopping one's urge to crave for more. It means being aware that all that we have is God-given, and we are just stewards to put all these to good use to bless others too. That is why the prayer, the Our Father, specifically tells us to pray for our daily bread and not our future bread. Worrying about the future can only extinguish one's hope, but reliance on the Lord to provide no matter what leads to peace of mind. Philippians chapter 4 verses 6 to 7 gives us the secret to contentment. Don't worry about anything, but in all your prayers, ask God for what you need, always asking Him with a thankful heart. And God's peace, which is far beyond human understanding, will keep your hearts and minds safe in union with Christ Jesus. One day, a father of a very wealthy family took his son on a trip to the country with a firm purpose of showing his son how poor people live. They spent a couple of days and nights on the farm of what would be considered a very poor family. On their return from their trip, the father asked his son, "How was the trip?" "It was great, Dad." "Did you see how people live?" the father asked. "Oh yeah," said the son. "So tell me, what did you learn from the trip?" asked the father. The son answered, "I saw that we have one dog and they had four. We have a pool that reaches to the middle of our garden and they have a creek that has no end. We have imported lanterns in our garden and they have the stars at night. Our patio reaches to the front yard and they have the whole horizon. We have a small piece of land to live on and they have fields that go beyond our sight. We have servants who serve us, but they serve others. We buy our food, but they grow theirs. We have walls around our property to protect us. They have friends to protect them." The boy's father was speechless. Then his son added, "Thanks, Dad, for showing me how poor we are." Isn't perspective a wonderful thing? Makes you wonder what would happen if we all gave thanks for everything we have, instead of worrying about what we don't have. In today's gospel, Jesus sends out his 12 apostles and instructs them to travel light to proclaim the good news. Take nothing for the journey, neither walking stick, nor sack, nor food, nor money, and let no one take a second tunic. We are called for the same mission as the 12 apostles through our proclamation and our lifestyle. In this era of great material prosperity and widespread poverty, we can reject the consumerism and individualistic mindset by living simple lives, living according to our needs, and sharing to help in other people's needs. Let us pray. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Heavenly Father, teach me to live a simple life, contented in your daily provisions, grateful in receiving them, and generous in sharing them with those who are in need. This I pray in Jesus' holy and mighty name. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless your families, brothers and sisters. God bless our Catholic faith and Couples for Christ.